Pericles once said, "What you leave behind is not what is engraved in stone mountains, but what is woven into the lives of others." As life blows left to right, what are you leaving behind? Is it a life skill which others can utilize? Connecting with children and teaching them a life skill is what generates a legacy of crafting. Today, on Legacy of Crafting, we showcase five craft artists who love yarn. With each strand that is plied together to compose a beautiful piece, my guests will tell you it was the love of their grandmother or mother, Florence Matilda Morse, a Carroll County native, who knitted their family together.
Hi, my name is Vanessa, and I'm here today to show you all of the skills that I have learned through sitting around the dining room table watching my grandmother and my mother crochet. As a young child, my grandmother always believed that a young child should have some type of hobby in order to stay out of trouble. So with that, my mom and my grandmother, through lots of patience, showed me how to do simple things like this tablecloth here, which is made from chains and scallop stitches. My grandmother's favorite stitch, which I loved to do, are the pineapple stitch, which is in this big purple tablecloth. This was her favorite. This piece here is a needlepoint stitching of Jesus Christ, which is my favorite. Out of all of the things that you see here that I've done, I am dedicating this to the skills that my mom had learned from her mother, Florence Morse. And throughout the years, we have tried to teach the younger generation how to do the things that were taught to them, such as knitting and crocheting.
My name is Diane Costley McMillan. As everyone knows, that I'm the daughter of the late Florence Morse. She inspired all of us, or matter of fact, all her kids, in doing some kind of craft. My craft is knitting. As you can see, my blanket is knitting. I do blankets and personalize them with names and the designs that they request. Okay. Is this funny?
There's risk of cardiovascular events such as heart attacks.
The blanket.
There's also very.
My passion is plastic canvas. Being that I am the youngest girl of the family, I like doing this since I have retired from the state employees. So, as you can see, my basket is also weaved with plastic canvas equipment with yarn, as well as the leaves.
Hi, my name is Mary. My mother taught me how to crochet, and these are some of my many blankets that I do. This one is Pittsburgh Steeler colors, and over here to the side, this one is called a miter blanket. All the miters come up here, and over here, for smaller children, this is good for at birth until they're toddlers. They get to learn all their colors.
Oh, they have
little bumps on
bumps
them.
Bumps.
Yeah, it's supposed to look like a like baby X's. Blocks. Uh-huh. You know, okay. Like tumbling blocks for children. I have a front post afghan here for an infant. I also have a basket weave afghan. I have a single crochet with clusters going around it, and I also have a sweater, a hat, and booties. Which
that's what you was working on.
87.
See the pinwheels?
87.
The pinwheels are really pretty.
This is my granddaughter. Cece is her nickname, Cassandra. Explain to me about your hats that you made off of a loom.
I've made these hats off of a loom for about 2 months now.
Right.
It all starts when we put the yarn onto the loom. We have to spread it out, make sure that we have two. One won't work anymore. Me and Grandma have experimented that.
Yes, because it turns out when you use one strand, it makes your hats very flimsy, and which we don't want because the children may not be warm enough. So it requires that we have two strands to use. And these are some of the hats that she has made. I even got her involved in trying to crochet. Get your hat there. That she can make hats for toddlers.
What motivates you to crochet or knit or plastic canvas?
I, for one, is my mom. My mother passed away 21 years ago, and it's an honor to keep her memory alive. So wherever I go, I have a project in tow.
Watching my mom work on her pieces, and it was really interesting and fascinating. Just sitting there watching her do what she had to do, what she wanted to do. And I wanted to see whether or not I could try it. And once I tried it, I liked it, and I'm hooked on it.
What aspect of your project draws you into completing it the most?
When I start a project, to be honest, it all depends on my mood. I crochet and knit to think, to get grounded, to relieve stress. And I work on it a little bit here, a little bit there. And normally, the projects that I work on usually shouldn't take more than a month to complete, but this is very therapeutic for me, so it takes me much, much longer to complete a project.
How has the yarn industry changes affected your projects?
Depending on the season, a lot of the colors that you might be using may not be available. Like with this purple piece, that's a fall color. And usually when I'm working on a piece, depending on the mood that I'm in, it might not be the season for the yarn to be available. And usually we can buy yarn in bulk to save money, but now that's become a problem where even the bulk prices for yarn is really expensive, so you're really not saving when you try to buy it in bulk.
And what I've noticed is it used to be an 8-ounce ball cotton for a certain price. They lessened the ball weight. It's now 7 ounces, and the price has gone up. So therefore, when you make your projects, you have to calculate extra balls in order to finish one, or you may not have enough of the same color.
Today's market has affected me by when my mom says that I can pick one piece of yarn, I pick 2 pieces of yarn, and she says it's too much, so she tells me to put it back in.
Mama, how long does it take for you to make a basket?
Well, for this particular basket, it takes me approximately like 3 weeks. You have to gather up your material, then you have to do your cuttings of the flower, and then getting all the other excess stuff and then trying to get it all together. You gotta pull your wires and try to weave it into your threading and stuff. So it takes me about 3 weeks.
My favorite stitches, making shells. Also doing things that I don't know how to do. As far as I see a new pattern that I like to do, and they may have a double, triple crochet. I never experienced on how to do that. I have to go ask someone in order to try to understand how to make that particular stitch. Sometimes the stitches can be found in your project book in order to show you how to make the stitch that you do not know how to make. So once you purchase a book or pick it up on the computer, speaking with different people that you enjoy crafting with, they may know the problems that I'm having, and they can bail you out of.
And do you donate any of your projects to any organization? If so, who and why do you do it?
I donate my projects sometimes to the school that my grandson goes to as fundraisers. And I did one for Shock Trauma Unit as a fundraiser they were having. So a lot of times I donate my projects. And it's nice to make for a wedding gift or something as well.
Some of my projects is donated to Office of Aging, Senior Citizen, Katie.
I like to do projects for family members and friends just so they'll have a little piece of me.
I like to donate my projects to the hospital for the children.
Cassandra, where do you donate your hats to?
We like to donate our hats to the hospitals.
Martha, how does it make you feel to look at a piece that you and your granddaughter has completed?
It makes me feel extra good and I feel real wonderful about it.
It's fun spending time with my grandma because she's patient and she loves spending time with me.
But these are still nice though.
So is that going to be like patchwork?
With a darker brown though.
Something like that. These you have to really look at.
Okay. Praying hands.
They and the pattern is called saying that they washcloths, but to me I use them like Tinsy said, it could be like placemat. Well, it could be
to me, that's a praying hand to me.
Yep.
It is.
That's
different.
Is
this is a, you know, like the people have on their cars.
Breast cancer.
Yeah.
The ribbons. The ribbons.
Yeah, ribbons. That's the word. I don't know what that is.
It's an Elmer Fudd.
Who is it?
The guy from Bugs Bunny.
Yeah.
Oh.
They're all characters.
Oh, okay.
Oh, that is pretty, Tinksy.
Yeah, well, it's not going to be finished yet.
But check out the little boobs in the puffies on the arms.
Well, I have to assemble her. She's a little beheaded.
So what are you going to do?
Show you her slip. This is her slip.
That is nice. Boy, that's a lot of work. That's like
this
that.
Is her skirt.
That goes over top
of it. Oh, it spreads out.
Oh, is that pretty?
It is pretty.
Because I don't know how to start. That's my problem.
This is the train. This is the train. This is why it's not
finished. Man, I would have to have her in a glass thing if I was made something like that. I thought the train goes in the back.
It does. It loops.
In other words, she's starting the train. She's got to make it go flare out in the back.
So that's as far as I got with that one.
That's pretty.
And oh, yeah.
Cassie at the craft show. All right, Cassie, show us what you got. Tell us what it is.
Pot holder.
Okay. What is your legacy for crafting?
What I would want people to remember me is that even though we've lost our mom, I want them to know that she lives through me and this is some of the work that she taught me and I'm passing it on because it lasts forever and ever and ever.
Crafting has brought me closer to my family and that means the most to me than anything. Having the quality time with my mother and my aunt and my niece makes me feel all the love and the joy that my grandmother put in to the work that she has bestowed to us. And it's heartfelt to me, as well as everyone here. And knowing that we can take these skills and pass them on to the next generation, nothing will ever be forgotten. It'll just continue to be added on like a pyramid or endless chain.
Thank you for watching Legacy of Crafting.